Our guest is the incomparable Kathy Lieber. Kathy, thanks for taking time out of your busy WSOP schedule. Really appreciate it.
No problem. My pleasure.
Now, let's talk about your career. You were born in Nashville. I know that. And I read somewhere that you began your career as a prop player in Colorado. First of all, can you explain to our listeners what a prop player is? And can you talk about how that helped you later on as you advanced through the ranks?
Sure. A prop player is someone that's paid by the casino to help fill seats. So if you come into a casino and there's nobody there to play poker with, you're just going to walk out and leave. So they like to have a few people there that are ready to sit there and play so they can start the game. So that's basically what we do. We get paid to play poker.
Okay, so I guess as you're getting paid to play poker, you're thinking, hey, this is a pretty cool job. They're giving me money to do something I like to do anyway. But there must have become a point where you said to yourself, listen, I can make more money winning pots than getting paid by the casino. So how did you approach being a prop player? Did you take it as an education of sorts? Did you want to learn? And can you tell us what you did learn?
Right. I've been playing poker a little bit up in the mountains. There's Central City Blackhawk. They had just opened up some poker rooms, and there's a $5 maximum limit. And I had just started getting started playing more and more and enjoyed it. And I thought, okay, why not get paid to play? So I took the job. And, you know, sometimes you had to play when it was shorthanded, and you had to basically play in any game they wanted you to. You know, they'd move you around and stuff. So you had to become pretty adept at playing in shorthanded games or moving or playing any game they wanted you to. But eventually the games were pretty good, and sometimes they would make you get up for their paying customers. And that's when I realized, you know, I don't necessarily want to do this prop job. I'd rather just play and make money, you know, that way. So I ended up not propping for too long. We had some home games in Colorado that I played in, as well as playing in the casinos. And that's basically how I learned how to play poker.
Yeah, at some point you said to yourself, wait a minute, I want to be in these juicy contests. Now, when did you realize and say to yourself, hey, Kathy, I'm getting pretty good at this game. When did you know that, let's say, you were better than the average poker player?
Well, I started playing off as a prop in, like, 1992. And I was doing okay, but I had my ups and downs, and I was learning as I went along. And in 1994, I had been making decent money. I mean, we're playing not really super high, 4-8, 10-20, $5 limit. But I was not making enough to pay the bills. My friends told me there was a great tournament in Las Vegas. It was 1994, and I hadn't really gone to tournaments. And I was like, well, why would I want to do that? They're like, oh, no, you should try it. You know, so I went out and bought some books on tournament poker and studied up a little bit and decided this will be a good test for me because I'd been doing okay just playing small games. But I really hadn't, you know. So I studied up. And went out there, and in my very first week, I chopped up a couple tournaments and won over $30,000.
Wow.
And that's when I started thinking, hey, this poker, you know, maybe I really can compete it at a higher level.
So what's the difference between a cash game and a tournament structure where if you lose your chips, you can't rebuy, you're out?
Well, I think that in the tournaments, you have to know when to change gears. You have to know when to be aggressive, when to steal the blinds, when to go after the chips. In a cash game, when the blinds are fixed, you can play a little bit more. You don't have to be as aggressive. You can kind of wait for hands more. You can be a little bit more patient. In tournaments, there's a time to be patient, and there's also a time to be more aggressive and go after the chips. And you can't just sit there and wait for a hand in tournaments sometimes because the blinds get big. So you have to know when to gamble and when not to.
I got to ask you, when you're at the final table of a World Poker Tour event, you're playing against some of the most talented, some of the best poker players in the world, and you're playing for so much money, did you ever let those thoughts invade your head that, hey, just 10 years ago, I was a prop player? Did that sort of thing ever creep into your head, or was it all focus at the table? Because I got to say, when I watch you on TV, you seem like you're one of the most focused poker players around. You got that stare going.
Well, there's times when I'm more focused than less focused. I mean, certainly when you're playing in the final table, you want to be as focused as possible. So, I mean, you know, when I'm playing in a tournament, you know, you don't have to focus 100% all the time because that would be very hard to do, you know, but hopefully you're focused when it counts.
What does it mean to you when I say that you've won nearly $6 million or in that range on the tournament trail?
I mean, I feel like I've been very successful at poker over the years, for sure. And if you told me 10 years ago when I was propping playing $5 limit that I'd be playing, you know, the biggest buyer tournament, 10,000, and being a season on TV and playing at the high levels and all these big tournaments, I wouldn't have really believed it. So, I mean, so yeah, it has been, you know, it is kind of an amazing thing when I think back to think that, you know, I never would have believed that I'd be playing so many big tournaments and making so much money at it. But, I mean, you know, poker is very volatile. You have a lot of ups and downs. You know, the last couple of years, I haven't had the results that I used to have. And you have to learn how to handle the ups and downs, manage your money, and manage your bankroll. So, you know, I don't really look at it like, oh, wow, I've won $6 million. I've looked at it like, wow, I've done well in the past, but how can I maintain myself so that if I don't always run good, that I'm still okay financially? You know, I think most poker players, that's where they have a problem. They, you know, they make so much money so fast, they think it's always going to come so easily, and they don't really prepare for the downswings, which always, you know, there's ups and downs. You know, no matter how good you are, there's always going to be ups and downs.
All right, now, there's a lot of emphasis these days placed on winning that coveted gold bracelet. We see Phil Hellmuth winning his 12th just the other day, and perhaps he's the guy that's put all the emphasis on winning a bracelet. But talk about that event in 2004, a shootout event. Can you explain to our listeners what a shootout is? And also, if you can, Kathy, can you tell us your feelings about the importance of winning a bracelet at the WSOP?
Yeah, shootout is basically like a one-table sit-and-go, except for it's winner-take-all. You play at one table of 9 or 10 people, and you just have to beat your table. So it's almost like a satellite where you just sit down, and you if you beat your table, then you move on, and you play another table where you have to beat your table. And then if you do that, then you're at the final table, and then so it's basically just beating a 3 one-table tournament. You know, winning is always better than coming in second, and I've had a long history of coming in second a lot, so winning is definitely a great relief and a great experience. I've come second in a couple WSOP events, and that was pretty disappointing, although, you know, the money is still pretty good. You always want to get first.
Yeah, let's talk about a few of your seconds. One in particular, the one to Steve Brecker that I alluded to in the intro. I mean, that was one of the longest WPT heads-up matches ever. Can you talk about the ebb and flow of a heads-up match when you get down to one-on-one?
Yeah, I mean, you know, like you said, it was actually a great structured tournament, so we were pretty exhausted by the time we got heads-up. And the blinds were still pretty reasonable, so we didn't have to get in there and just, you know, move in every hand. It wasn't like it was just a shove test. But, you know, heads-up, definitely a game that's more aggressive and reading the player, and you have to play a lot more hands. And it's definitely a whole different dynamic than playing at a full table. You know, basically playing almost every hand, and you can't necessarily wait for a big hand because you get blinded off. So you kind of have to know, you know, when to play and when not to play and be willing to gamble up a little bit more.
I'm wondering what your thoughts are on how I intro'd you when I said the greatest female poker player ever. I suppose, does that bother you, first of all, to categorize it as, you know, the best female poker player ever? Or would you prefer if you were just, you know, talking about poker player in general?
I'm proud that I'm ranked number one in the all-time women's money list. I mean, that is definitely an accomplishment for me, and I feel good about that. You know, I really don't think of saying that I'm the number one female, best female player ever, because, you know, I mean, I grew up, when I was playing, there was very few women playing. You know, so my results was definitely better than the other women at that time, but I was playing more. And, you know, now things have changed so much. There's so many young internet-type players that have come up through the ranks that are playing a whole different style and having success with it. So, you know, I wouldn't say that Phil Ivey or Phil Hellmuth or myself or anybody, you know, just because you have the results doesn't necessarily mean that you're the greatest ever. You know, there's different factors, and obviously the number of tournaments you play. And, you know, I mean, I'm very proud of all the success I've had and that I've been able to make that much money at poker and be ranked number one on the list for so long. But, you know, it's not, you can't always keep it up. So, I mean, there's a lot of great women players out there. So I wouldn't want to disrespect them by saying I'm the best ever.
Let me ask you about this young Annette Overstad. Have you had the chance to play against her? I mean, I once read that she won a tournament playing with the hole cards on her computer laptop covered by a piece of paper. You know, she's been described a phenom, a savant. What are your thoughts on her, and have you played against her?
I haven't played with her all that often. I actually played with her in the 25K WPT Championship, where she put a bad beat on me. She raised in late position. I re-raised her. And I guess she thought maybe I was in a move. She shoved. I had kings, and she had ace-9. And she wound up making aces-4. I think I wound up even hitting a king. But so she made aces-4. I made kings-4. But all the money was in pre-flop. And so she's a very aggressive player. I don't know her that well to know whether she's, I mean, I know she's very aggressive, and she's had some success doing that. You know, I know there's a lot of really good young women out there that are playing that are doing very well these days.
Well, how about Vanessa Selfs? How would you describe her? Have you played against her? I mean, again, there's a woman that her opponents call ultra, ultra aggressive.
Yes, I have played with her. I was actually at the final table with her as well as at other tables a few times with her. And she is. She's very aggressive. She's very intimidating. She's very tough. And, you know, I have to have a lot of respect for her because she does scare people at the table. I mean, she does intimidate. And, you know, she doesn't always back down. Whereas a lot of women tend to be a little bit more timid, she's definitely the exact opposite of that.
All right, well, I'd like to try to get into the psyche of a poker player there. When you talk about Vanessa Self to the table and the fact that she intimidates her opponents, I mean, she's not going to take them out back and beat them up. You know, she's not going to hurt them physically. So can you explain what you mean by that? How does she intimidate an opponent? Is it simply that you got to be careful with her because if you make this move, she's going to be more aggressive and put you to the test? Is that what you mean?
Yeah, pretty much. Like if you raise, she might re-raise you. And if you re-raise her back, she might just put you all in. You know, she's constantly putting the pressure on you, so she makes you not want to take a stand against her. She makes you want to back off if you're unsure or you don't want to miss call your chips. So she puts the pressure on you that you feel like your chips are all at risk. And you never know what she has because she can be aggressive with a really good hand or with a marginal hand. Whereas some other players, they might play a little bit tighter when you raise them. Unless they have a really good hand, they'll just fold. So she's scarier in the sense that she puts the pressure on you. Do you really want to take that much risk? Do you want to gamble with her? Do you want to raise her when you know that she might be putting the test on you? Do you want to play for all your chips? And that can be a very effective strategy, and that can be intimidating.
All right, you talked earlier about the prize money that you've won, but the fact that in the last couple of years it's been slow going for you. And you talked about the importance of money management, which is a very key characteristic of any successful poker player. Can you talk about your background outside of poker? Is it true that you were in the financial end of things? Was it stocks? Was it financial management?
Yes, I was a business finance major in college, so I learned how to understand the stock market and make investments and manage money. And so when I started doing well at poker, my initial instinct was to invest in the market and to trade and do things and make other investments so that, I wouldn't have to count on just winning at poker. Because even though I was running really well my first few years, I knew it might not last forever. And everyone told me that all poker players go broke and you don't know because everyone has their ups and downs. And I said, I'm not going broke. And they said, no, you don't understand. Every poker player, no matter how good you are, goes broke because you're not always going to win. And actually, I have never gone broke because I've always invested my money and managed my money in such a way that even though I'm a big risk taker in some ways, I'm conservative in that I'm not putting all my money on the table at any one time.
Well, that's a very good strategy indeed. Okay, Kathy, what we do on the show here is we play a game called Rapid Fire. And what I do is I throw out some names, some terms, and I just want to get your reaction to them as I throw them out. Is that okay? Here we go. The rudest thing a man has ever said to you at the poker table.
I had John Benetti yelling at me once, you know, and calling me a bitch and stuff like that.
Can you tell us the background of that story? Tell us why he did that?
Yeah, he was cursing and talking under his breath and complaining to the dealers and all this stuff. And I went over to the floorman quietly and told the floorman, you know, can you please watch him because he's being very rude and obnoxious and everything like that. The floorman came right over to him and said to him, we had a complaint about you. And then he starts yelling, oh, who complained about me? This little bitch here and this and that. I don't remember exactly all the words he used, so I wouldn't want to remember. But he was very rude and very insulting.
And that was John Benetti?
Yes.
Okay. How about the nicest thing someone's ever said to you at the poker table or away from it?
I can't think of one particular nice thing, but I have had a few people come up to me at different times and say, wow, you know, I played with you, you're a real pleasure, you know, you got bad beat and you didn't get upset, you didn't yell, you were just very nice and pleasant and, that kind of thing. That makes me feel good because a lot of poker players, when they do take bad beats, they criticize their opponent or they get mad or angry. And I have done that occasionally, but I try not to. I really realize that when people come up to me and say that from 10 years ago, oh, you were so nice, that it really makes a difference. I try to not let my emotions, affect me. And so I try not to be upset or yell at people or act out my emotions if I can avoid it.
The legend that is Tom DeJuan.
He seems like a really great guy. I mean, just the fact that he was the only one of the Team Full Tilt pros that stepped up and said, look, you know, I'm going to give back all this money that I got from Full Tilt if we don't get paid back. He seems like a phenomenal poker player. I really haven't played with him that much. But he seems like he's very smart and a very kind of class act.
Jennifer Harmon.
Jennifer's a great player. She's one of the few women that plays in the highest games, you know. So she's been very successful. I like Jennifer. I respect the fact that she can play at such a high level with some of the, she plays like at the Doyle's Room with the, at the highest stakes, and it's been successful.
All right. Of all the poker games, which is your favorite and why?
Well, I mean, the game I play the most and I've had the most success at is No Limit Hold'em. But I actually also enjoy Pot Limit Omaha 8 better, because that's a game that not a lot of people play, and there are really a lot of people that don't know how to play it well, that don't understand the hand values. So if I could play a poker tournament every single day, I think I'd take Pot Limit Omaha 8 better.
The New York Stock Exchange.
I'm hoping it goes a lot higher soon.
All right, the broadcast team of Sexton and Van Patten.
Yeah, they're great. I like Mike's voice. I like Mike's commentary. He's definitely very entertaining and a great commentator. Van Patten, I mean, he's just there to lighten it up a little bit, I guess.
All right, the nickname, Poker Cat.
Yeah, I started that when that was my email address, POKERKAT, and now it's also my Twitter. So if you want to follow me on Twitter, it's PokerCat with a K.
All right, now, I haven't asked you this, but I know you have a long-lasting, friendly relationship with a world champion of the main event, Tom McAvoy. Can you talk about where you met Tom and how you two became such close friends? Because I know you are. He's told me about this in the past.
Yeah, before I came out to my first tournament in 1984, his was one of the books I read. And, there wasn't too many books on tournament strategy. He had one, and Dana Smith, or Shane Smith, was her pen name, were the only ones that I really thought on tournament strategy. So I went out there and did well, and Tom actually noticed me at all these final tables, and he approached me and went to, and said hello, and I told him I'd read his books, and ever since then we've been friends.
You know what, folks? She's a real pleasure. This is the first chance I've had to speak with her, and I really enjoyed it. She's won close to $6 million on the tournament trail. She's one of the best ever, best at the business, and that is Poker Cat, Kathy Lieber. Kathy, thanks for your time. Good luck at the series.